you know that I was a guest judge on the Netflix show Nailed It? This creepy clown cake that I'm making right here was the actual cake that I made for the show. Three amateur bakers were asked to recreate it, and hilarity ensued. Their clowns were definitely scary. I had a blast on the show. My fellow judges were hilarious, and the contestants were so sweet.
Nailed it.
You can watch my episode right now on Netflix, Season 3, Episode 2. I'm the one dressed like Beetlejuice. Did you know that I was a guest judge on the Netflix show Nailed It? This creepy clown cake that I'm making right here was the actual cake that I made for the show. Three amateur bakers were asked to recreate it, and hilarity ensued. Their clowns were definitely scary. I had a blast on the show. My fellow judges were hilarious, and the contestants were so sweet.
Nailed it.
You can watch my episode right now on Netflix, Season 3, Episode 2. I'm the one dressed like Beetlejuice. Did you know that I was a guest judge?
One Halloween night in 2013, a babysitter and the kids she's watching return home from trick-or-treating and discover a mysterious VHS tape mixed in with their Halloween tent. VHS tape contains three different short films with one common element. Each of them features a character that goes by Arse the Clown. The first short is called The Ninth Circle, and the first time we see Arse the Clown, he's creepily smiling at the camera in a montage where he's just one creepy clown amongst many demons, shadowy figures, and whatever this is. The first time we see Art in action, he appears seemingly out of nowhere to harass a young woman waiting for her train in Realmville Station. The woman ignores Art, but as we will come to learn, Art the Clown isn't someone who can be easily ignored. He literally carries a bag of tricks around with him to get people's attention. After politely asking him to stop, she decides to ignore him, so he saddles up next to her and hands her a flower, which is crawling with bugs. Her terror makes Art laugh hysterically, but also silently. Then, as she tries to run away, Art injects her with a sedative and takes her prisoner. The horn honking, the silent laughter, and the involuntary injections will remain some of Art's signature moves throughout his existence, but there's a huge difference in this short compared to everything that follows. Here, Art is literally working on behalf of the devil. His victim wakes up alongside two other women in a dungeon filled with the aforementioned demons and hideous creatures. So, is Art a demon? It would seem so here, but later on, there are also indications that he might be a disturbed human gifted with some supernatural ability. He feels pain, and he does die, albeit temporarily. The VHS tape that appears in Little Timmy's trick-or-treating hall is an anthology, which means that three separate, semi-amateur filmmakers made short films that incorporated Art the Clown. If this is true, then he must be something of an urban legend in this world. He's a known entity or a myth that people know about. So then, who or what is Art the Clown? How can I analyze the history of a character?
thirsty clowns have to start somewhere, here's how the creepy villain of Terrifier was born. Prior to becoming a box office draw, Art the Clown made his debut appearance in director Damien Leone's short films, with the first being The Ninth Circle. Leone told Entertainment Weekly that his idea for Art stemmed from a nightmarish idea he had over a decade.
Okay, we can. This guy.
What do you want to put? Yes, it's a Friday.
It's a Friday.
I bought some. I bought some, you know.
What do you mean, could be Friday?
No, I did. The.
In kindergarten, I was
concerned.
Nie wiem, da. No, musisz mi powiedzieć. Weź to! Nie wiem, co powiedz mi, co miałem.
No, I did. I bought some. No, no. I bought something on Friday, or Thursday.
Zapiekanka.
No, something I forgot it's called.
Called?
No, I forgot it's called.
No to powiedz mi, bo ja też nie
wiem. The filler to put first day.
Co od ciebie kupiłem?
First day. What?
Ja kupiłem first day.
Me, tata.
A co kupiliście?
The fillet.
A to ja nie... Fillet?
Ja put...
A nie zrobię lepsze.
Your boot. A pink, I don't know what it's called.
Okay, ja wiem. I'm sorry, stop.
A pink, I don't know. I don't know.
Tylko nie przegryź tego, okay? Masz.
Everything in a row. But unfortunately, our family did not particularly like fruit or vegetables.
A już przegryzłaś.
No, I didn't.
To Lizzie musiała podgryzać.
There were a lot of flower products.
I didn't touch it.
I was gaining more and more pounds, and it was getting harder to move. Against the background of thin classmates, I began to feel depressed, although it was as long as I can remember. And then I could not even
remember.
Okay.
I could only fit into a tracksuit, and even the teachers didn't tell me anything about the dress code at school because they saw how fat I was. This pity on the part of the adults only made me feel worse. The family only avoided this topic, but refused to eat healthy food. I dieted a million times and broke down. Things as long as I can remember. And then I could not even pick up a beautiful ball gown. I could only fit into a tracksuit. And even the teachers didn't tell me anything about the dress code at school because they saw how fat I was. This pity on the part of the adults only made me feel worse. The family only avoided this topic, but refused to eat healthy food. I dieted a million times and broke down, then gained twice as much as I lost. Because of complexes before the prom night, I began to eat even more and gained another 5 kilos. For this reason, I decided not to go there at all. Because I thought too much about my figure, my academic performance was poor. I didn't have any friends, and I didn't play sports, so I didn't even count on a scholarship. 3 of the colleges have denied me admission due to objective reasons. Who needs a student with 0 achievements? My parents were willing to buy my education college, but I was ashamed of them and myself. I felt worthless. One day, sitting at the TV late at night, eating another batch of buns, I saw on TV a display of beautiful evening dresses and suddenly realized that I don't have any dresses. I've had wide leg trousers and t-shirts all my life. I stopped and looked at myself in the mirror. At that moment, I saw not only a fat body full of despair, but loneliness. The rest of my life. If I live at this pace, I will not only have no friends, but also love. I was suddenly afraid, and this fear grew with every spoonful of junk food. That night, I kept a notebook for myself where I wrote down my plans, food plan, lifestyle, and goal. I clearly scheduled everything by day of the week so as to not allow myself to snap again. The next day, I signed up for a gym that was far from home. I specifically chose one to walk back and forth. The first day I met the coach, his name was Noah. He understood me without a word and immediately drew up a program of classes. At first, it was very difficult for me. I felt the weight of my body. I was suffering from shortness of breath. My muscles were flabby like jelly. It was difficult for me among people I didn't know. All these new simulators, I didn't know what to do with them. I was very lost. My hands were shaking because I couldn't do it after 2 weeks of classes. So I came out after another failure in the hall and just roared. Nothing will help me now. I was born fat and I will die fat, I said aloud. At that moment, my coach came up to me. Noah said that working on yourself is the most difficult and showed me his photos. No, it can't be. He was even fatter than me. I weighed 200 kilograms. Only at that moment, I had a wife and child. At some point, I got depressed, just like you were eating. I ate everything, but especially a lot of hamburgers. Unbeknownst to me, I had grown so fat that I could no longer walk. Of course, I stopped working, and my wife had to support me, the child, and herself. It was hard for her, but she was silent and worked. I saw it all and hated myself even more. And then I left, so as to not hang a weight on the fragile shoulders of my beloved, he said. I asked what happened next. He said that now I see another person, strong in body and spirit. I showed you the photo, not so that you lose weight, but so that you don't give up. I have changed now. I started earning money by playing sports, but I still can't get my family back because I lost it over the years. I can't go in there now, and you don't give up. Don't make my mistakes before it's too late, he said. These words made me think about a lot. I came home and opened my notebook again. All the next day, I faithfully fulfilled all the tasks of the trainer, not sparing myself or the simulators. When I thought my heart was going to burst from the strain, I would stop, take a deep breath, and start again a few minutes later. My clothes were soaked with sweat, and my lungs were ready to burst with oxygen, but I didn't stop. About a month later, I got on the scales, and I saw that I weighed not 120. But 100 kilos! Minus 20 kilos! Yeah! I screamed in tears. I couldn't believe that I had lost as much as 20 kilos in 1 month. It was only at that moment that I noticed that I had been strapping my old pants with a belt for a long time. And my t-shirt was waving like a sail.
It's time for you to go shopping, Noah said, smiling.
In a rush of joy, I threw myself at him and hugged him. But this was not the limit. The next day, my mother and I went shopping, where I bought a new tracksuit. My mother asked me why I didn't buy a dress like I wanted, but I said I would only do it after I lost another 30 kilos. On the way home, she told me that she and my father were more proud of me than ever. I was happy to hear that. Well then, we went on another level of my diet and exercise. I took a double load. Over time, I noticed that sports became a way of life for me. I no longer wanted to eat unhealthy. Bad mood just because I was almost always happy. I had the pleasure aching pain in the muscles from easy dinner with a salad. Several times I was approached on the street on the way to the gym to get acquainted. Attention from the outside attracted not only elastic ass, I think I shone from the inside. After 2.5 months of intensive training, I achieved my result. My weight was 70 kilograms. After the weigh-in, I invited Noah home to celebrate. I introduced him to my parents. We had a lovely evening. The coach said I was his best student. And at the end of the dinner, my mother gave me a gift. She bought me a black evening dress. The first in my life. It was beautiful. I tearfully hugged my parents, then put on my new clothes as soon as possible. And you know, this dress has become a symbol of the will to win and work on yourself. This feeling where the back zipper closes without any problems in the back and does not cut into the fat is incomparable, I whispered to my mother. Then Noah and I went straight to the club. He said that people should see me today. Now it's time for a new life.
Hi everyone, I'm Jessica. I'm 18 years old. I want to tell you my thick story. This is a fairly common problem. I weigh more than 90 kilograms. To be honest, it is difficult for me to talk about it now, and it is unpleasant to remember. But I still want to tell you about all this, because maybe then someone will think about whether they correctly characterize their life positions. I've been fat all my life, from childhood. I was born plump and round-cheeked and all. But if at the beginning it still touches the environment, the older you get, the harsher and tougher the world treats you. For girls, I believe in general, much higher requirements for external beauty than for men. This is how it's happened historically. The first time I encountered the problem that hashtag I am not like others was when I was probably not even 3 years old. I went to a dance class at the time, and I didn't understand why some of the kids avoided me. Until the scorn and mockery came out in the open. And it started, I won't say that every day, but for my characteristic, I got it. Every time I tried to make friends there, the guys would say something like, don't make friends with her, she's fat. Can you imagine? I was only 3 years old. I still remember. Children's grievances are very difficult to forget. I don't remember if I was really fat, but I stood out for sure. There were, of course, good guys, but they were more than overlaid by those who made me remember nothing good from my childhood. But despite this, I still loved to dance. Even if I was alone sometimes, but at the moment of dancing, I forgot all the problems and did not feel plump, fluttered like a butterfly. At school, of course, the bullying did not stop, but on the contrary, became even stronger. I tried not to pay attention to them and not give them special significance. Children, I can tell you, can be very cruel sometimes. Fat lady, a barrel, a cow. What you will not hear in your address at school. I have noticed that people do not like those who stand out or somehow separate from the teens.
If you somehow separate, then your most noticeable feature is turned into a flaw that needs to be mocked. Smart nerd, glasses bespectacled, full fat, thin worm, etc. Besides, I didn't have any friends. I tried everything to lose weight. I went to fitness halls, followed different diets, and starved myself. But all came up empty. Because everyone treats me like this. I was kind of depressed all the time. It was only when I was eating that I could cheer myself up a little. Apparently everything would have continued like this if I hadn't had one situation happen to me. After graduation. Graduation. How are we? Everyone was preparing, and I just watched from the sideline. And at that moment, the prom was supposed to be held. I loved two things, dancing and eating. But when we were sharing in pairs, I came across a very thin and tall guy named Dave. The others simply didn't want to, and he had no choice but to agree.
This is the Trimble Family. Life is good.
Ой, теряли чинить.
There was a problem. There was an element in the dance where the guys have to lift the partner and spin, and Dave wouldn't have been able to lift me or even put his arms around me. But I couldn't miss it, and I gave my word that no matter...
I'm not strong enough to bear it, or I didn't want it that much. Already. Desperate, I just decided to go to a secret meeting of anonymous fatties, thinking that maybe there I will find some comfort for myself. I had never been to such meetings before, and I was wondering what stories someone had. Basically, everyone has the same problems. Everyone told me what they had to go through because of this, so to speak, feature. And I'm not the only one. At the meeting, I met a happy, sweet girl named Heather. Got into conversation, and I found out that we have a lot of similarities. She was also very complex because of her excess weight. Tried various methods of weight loss, but all in vain. But at these meetings, she realized that being overweight is not a problem. She explained that beauty can be different, and it is not necessary to be thin. We had a nice chat, and I told her my upcoming situation, to which she replied that there is a good and unusual solution to my problem. And here is graduation day. Heather helped me pack, picked up an insanely beautiful dress, and made a stunning makeup. I admit I didn't expect to look like this myself. Everyone in school froze in surprise at the sight of me. In their eyes, I saw that they were amazed at my appearance. It gave me confidence, and I wasn't as shy as I used to be. During the dance, on the advice of my new friend Heather, on the element when guys would lift their partners in their arms, I picked up Dave instead. Everyone laughed at this moment, but it was no longer a mocking laugh, but a laugh of admiration. We even received an award for this number as the most creative dance. I will never forget that night, because that's when I realized that you don't have to be thin to be beautiful. And
this is weird.
We're all tagged. Our names are at the table. Why us?
Hello everyone, my name is Monica. I'm going to tell you about how I wanted to grow 10 centimeters and why. I've always been not very tall, or more precise, I was petite, 150 centimeters, and it annoyed me. Despite my height, I still had good, kind friends who were always supportive and jokingly called me baby, a nickname that accompanied me everywhere. I tried to make myself look a little older with heels and strict pantsuits, but I couldn't always wear that. Sometimes I wore sports clothes or jeans, and, you know, they wouldn't let me in the clubs. The cops would come up at night, assuming I was a lost, homeless teenager. Ugh, and one time, I was walking with an ex-boyfriend, and he walked me home. We stood and talked, and then he wanted to kiss me. He bent over almost twice to reach me, and I got on my toes, and still we couldn't reach each other. Then he wrapped his arms around my face, and I grabbed his neck, with only a couple of millimeters left. But suddenly, someone hit him on the forearm from behind. My boyfriend fell to the ground, and I stood there, shocked. It was the cops again. They thought he was a maniac who was forcibly trying to kiss me. I yelled so much that my mother heard me yell. She ran out into the street and screaming, and saw me beating the cops for hurting my boyfriend. Anyway, we were both taken to the station, and had to pay a fine for assaulting a police officer. After that, there was no sign of my boyfriend anymore. I met another guy 6 months later. He was tall too, though. Everyone was tall to me. I fell in love with this handsome guy so much that my head was blown off, very much so. To avoid the past sad experience, I decided not to kiss him until I waited for the right moment. So we went on dates for more than a month, and he was already so-and-so, and I was still dodging, more for evil on the street everywhere patrolled by police. I would not be surprised the same way, those destroyers of my personal life. I should have sued them for my heartbreak in the past. So I thought of something. I invited my boyfriend home when no one was around, then got a stepladder and climbed up on it, supposedly to show him something interesting on the wall. He came up to me, at which point I kissed him. Ugh, it was awesome. That's when I realized how good it felt to be tall, and I wanted to grow at least 10 centimeters taller. I didn't tell the guy about my grand plan. I didn't want to seem pathetic. I just imagined how I would suddenly appear in front of him tall, taller at least by 10 centimeters, and even in heels. The first thing I thought of was cosmetic surgery and went to the clinic for a consultation. Do you know what I heard? That they would break my bones in two places, then connect them again with special pins, and that I would walk with crutches for the first 6 months, then switch to a cane. It would still depend on my body. It was a nightmare. Who will love me with crutches, even if I'm tall? Besides, it wasn't cheap, so I quickly gave up on that idea. Then I began to read on the internet about different ways to exercise and eat, and I actively started exercising. By this time, my boyfriend had gone to visit his grandmother for a month. I was glad. It was good for me because I didn't want him to notice anything strange. I hadn't seen much of him lately anyway. We even fought a few times. He asked me out, but I told him I couldn't go because I had to do things at home. I was actually on my way to practice. The first 5 times, he was still silent, and then I saw him right outside my house. I was so surprised. What are you doing here?
Waiting for you. I called your home phone. Your mom said you weren't home and you didn't have anything to do.
Yeah, I just... You know, Christine is in trouble, and she asked me to help and not to tell anyone.
I called Christina, too. Your friend said you weren't at her place.
Oh, well...
I just came by to say I'm going away for a couple of days. I haven't seen you in a couple of weeks. I just wanted to see you one last time. I'll be back in a month.
Right after he said that, he left. I tried to catch up with him, but the cops were hanging around again. Shit! I shouted inside myself and went inside. I decided to work even harder so that by the time he arrived back, I would have grown at least a couple more centimeters. I spent almost 12 hours straight at the gym. There I ate and rested for a while, then worked out again. My body ached and sometimes I got dizzy, but I didn't have time. To avoid distractions on my phone, I just turned it off. Then there were texts and missed calls from Steve. But I was so tired by then that I couldn't answer the phone anymore. I just texted that I missed him and apologized for a disconnected phone. I also took a personal trainer just in case. It was a guy who helped me with stretching and exercises.
Did it hurt? Yep, I yelled like a victim.
But the deadline was tight, so I asked him not to feel sorry for me. A couple of days later, I suddenly got sick at the gym. I lost my balance and almost fell face down on the weights. I was caught by the trainer. He pulled me toward him and I fell on top of him. It was an awkward moment. Before I could get up, someone picked me up like a toy and put me on the floor like a doll. It was Steve, my boyfriend. I wondered why he came home so quickly, and instead of hugging me, he threw his arms around my coach and they started fighting right there in the gym. My boyfriend was also an athlete. Even security couldn't break him up. I was screaming my head off. I couldn't figure out what was going on. Somebody called the cops and in came the same 2 people I already knew. They took me and Steve to the station right away.
You again, but someone else. What are you talking about? What do you mean by you again?
Nothing. What right do you have to talk about it at all?
That's what I thought.
What were you thinking?
The drama's about to start. Look,
he said to his colleague. Steve was even more enraged by this. He got up out of his chair and started screaming that he thought I was cheating on him, that he lied to me and he wasn't going anywhere, that I didn't even remember that his grandmother had died 7 years ago, and that I was running off to my other boyfriend at the gym. I listened to this and then started laughing wildly. Steve got even more pissed off. I went to the gym for a different reason, I told him. He wouldn't listen. Then I blurted out, if those two hadn't followed me everywhere, I wouldn't have wanted to increase my height by 10 centimeters in an emergency. I yelled at the cops, and they looked at me in surprise, and one of them said,
you think we have nothing better to do than follow you? Come down from heaven. Give up on us. It's not our fault there was a maniac living in your neighborhood, and we thought you were his victim. Who knew you were making out with your boyfriend? What boyfriend?
The maniac? Who was he?
No. Do you have another boyfriend after all?
No, I mean, the maniac. That's more important.
You'll be in danger from your other boyfriend. Quiet. You're both in danger now if you don't stop yelling. Take it outside the precinct.
There were a lot of questions. A lot. We then sat down for another hour of discussion. Turns out I was the only one who was worried about my growth issues. I got myself all worked up. Of course, I had to tell Steve about my ex, but since it was 6 months before I met him, he reacted okay. Said the past was the past. He was more concerned about other things. I apologized for forgetting about his grandmother, for misleading him, and for not telling him everything right away. It's just, I liked you a lot and I didn't want to lose you, I told him.
Your cutest feature in your appearance is your height,
he told me, and kissed me.
There was a cop on the side. You're still at the station, actually,
the cop said.
I exhaled.
Afterward, we went to the gym and apologized,
but I never went back there again.
I put my thoughts and complexes about my height aside altogether and stopped obsessing. And you know, after a year, I still grew by as much as 2 centimeters. That was really cool. Maybe my friends didn't notice, but I can feel the difference when I kiss Steve. So friends, who else here is short stature? Write in the comments how tall you are and...
I wanted to sneak into my room, but bumped into Chad by the collar and said to get lost. Did not attract me, but they also did not repel me. Could I imagine myself with a drawing? I couldn't even imagine myself in a dress. My head didn't work like that. But maybe we should try it. If, for example, I did something small somewhere under the neck, from the back. Oh, okay, Vic. Let's do it.
I had no idea that it would take so long, and then I should go with polyethylene sheeting for a few days.
I always wanted to take it off. I already regretted what I had done 200 times, and Vic kept forbidding me to touch and pick at the wound. And he was absolutely right. I didn't really see the drawing, but I could feel myself changing under his influence. How I walked with my back straight, how I wanted to constantly show the drawing. I began to worry about why I had tattooed the drawing in such an inconvenient place from the very beginning. Of course, I chose a place that my parents might not see, but damn, could I tattoo something else? I avoided the thought until the last moment, tried not to think about it, but everything around me seemed to say, come on, Tracy, make up your mind, it's so easy. My friends who wanted to have a tattoo from Vic. Sometimes he had orders every day. And we sat in the evening and laughed about how suddenly his business went up. But one day, I blurted out, on the next drawing, and Vic immediately seized on this miscue, lit up, and said, well, let's do it. I was stubborn. I reminded him about my parents. But deep down, I had already made up my mind. A couple of ideas for tattoos turned into a couple of hundred. We didn't have time to do everything. It was physically impossible. But one small drawing followed another. On the leg, on the arm, on the stomach. What? Do you think this was the end of the story? Ha! Not so. I became a model for Vic. He was shooting me for his portfolio, and in the process, we discussed new ideas.
and we were very excited about the idea for his salon. He had already completed the paperwork and was looking for a place with cheap rent to prepare it and hire employees. I was so happy for him. Eventually, Vic opened the door to a world I couldn't and didn't want to get out of. It remained only to reconcile my parents with this information. Uh-oh. When they returned from the sea, they did not believe what they saw at first. They thought that I had painted myself with a marker on a bet with my friends, laughed, and sent me to wash away this nightmare. I also laughed and said that water could not wash it off. My mother was the first to get nervous. Then it came to my father. Vic was with me the whole time. I kept trying to persuade him to hide in his rented apartment, but he remained as stubbornly honest and decided to explain everything to my parents and take responsibility for his actions. Well, it all ended predictably. Dad almost destroyed him on the spot, banned him from our house, yelled at me for giving in to the corrupting influence of a vile brother. He threw Vic out, took my phone and internet, locked me in my room, and spent another half day running around the house screaming, "Gods, my daughter looks like a criminal now!" I did not lose heart, but almost immediately developed a plan. I had to wait a few days until my mother relented and suggested that we spend the evening as a family watching a movie. My laptop, and instead of clicking the play button, I started calling Vic in Messenger. He was about as confused as Pa and Ma, but I took the initiative and started talking non-stop. Yes, Pa and Ma, Vic did my tattoos. It was my idea, and I ended up asking Vic to paint me, and I didn't want to stop. No, it wouldn't go away. No, I didn't want them to disappear. Yes, I had made up my mind that this was how I wanted to look. I was still going to study game design. They had seen worse things. No, I didn't have skin cancer, and I would be very careful that it didn't occur. Maybe one day I would remove them all. Who knew? And I asked not to get mad at Vic. Besides the tattoos, he made me go to bed at 10 and eat vegetables. Mom and Dad listened to me carefully, and Dad said, "You won't stop." That, will you?
Nah.
I promised and gave him a big hug. And then I hugged Mom, and would have hugged Vic if the monitor screen had allowed it. Of course, it wasn't easy for them to accept the way I look now. Yes, even I sometimes felt strange seeing myself in the mirror. But the house arrest was commuted. That's the main thing. See yourself, girl, and subscribe to her channel, as well as send your stories.
There's definitely only one goat, and there's only one biscuit for your biscuit bread, and one person to tell you about it. Me, Trevor McDonald. Actually, it's Sir Trevor McDonald, and I'll take it from here. McVitie. True origin.
Let's turn it up!
At first, this idea seemed dubious to my mother. Plus, you also had to pay to be trained. But they took a chance and Dad learned, and then gradually began to take orders, and things went well. After a few years, he worked in the best salon in the city, on a level with other professionals. How her work was going, my mom sadly replied that she wasn't working, and then she was like, teach me how to do a tattoo. Dad almost choked on his food. Just about whether she could get them tattoos and why I don't have any. I never thought about that before. I thought it was optional. Even though my parents have tattoos, a few of them, I came home and immediately said that I wanted a tattoo. My mom and dad lost their minds. At first, they were indignant for a long time, but then they realized that they could not say no. You can understand why. Then my father said that he would allow me to get a tattoo with one condition, that it would be done either by him or by my mother. And I agreed. I was given until the weekend to choose a drawing and think about it properly, as well as to consult with my parents. All week I was racking my brain, choosing a large, then a small drawing. I could not decide. Then my mother came up to me. She advised me to make a small one, try to get used to it, to the sensations. To be honest, I was scared. Although my parents told me in detail how the process would take place, I was still worried, but it was normal. Then came Saturday. I went to the salon with my parents and asked my mother to make my first tattoo, and she agreed. They asked me again if I was ready and if I had made a conscious decision, and when they said yes, my mother invited me to sit down. In fact, I was more worried, and after 30 minutes, I had a tattoo of a small flower on my arm. It looked neat, unassuming, and I was pleased. It took about a week for the tattoo to heal. It itched, but I took good care of it. At first, I couldn't get enough of it. It's like when you buy yourself a cool new thing, only this is always with you. I often got questions from my friends. What if the tattoo gets boring? What to do then? In general, they can be taken off, but why? That is why my parents asked me if I was sure about the choice of the tattoo and if my decision was really consciously made. When everything was completely healed, the thought crept into my mind. What if I had more? My father and mother asked the same questions and invited me to the salon. This time I made a bigger drawing on my leg. I had a wolf's mouth all over my thigh. This drawing was in color, so I was worked on for several hours in a row, and not at once. My mother did a great job. She clearly displayed all the details, like she did with all her clients. In some places, I was a little sore, but in general, the sensations were tolerable. Finally, when the work was completely finished, there was another drawing on my leg, and it looked just bomb. And the funny thing is that 6 months later, I thought about another tattoo. It became like an addiction. My father told me about it. Lots of his clients often come for him for new tattoos after getting one. So, in a total of 2 years, my mother gave me about 20 tattoos. My arms, legs, stomach, neck, and lower back were all clogged up. At school, my teachers told me off, but my parents stood up for me, and that was what I liked the most. Do I consider my body beautiful? Yes, but it also warms me to think that my mother did all this work for me. Isn't it wonderful? Now her work will always remain with me. Would you take it?
Hello, everyone. I'm Tracy, 18 years old. Have your tastes changed with age? For example, when you were a child, you hated cauliflower, and now you can't live without it? For example, I have always thought that tattoos are strange and dangerous and ugly. Watch this video to the end and find out how it happened that I tattooed myself almost completely. A year ago, my folks gathered at the sea to celebrate the anniversary of their relationship. Yeah, cool. I was all for it. Why not? But at this time, my aunt's son, Vic, was going to visit us. He was going to open this, selling iron, boxes, beads. Come on, guys. I don't know. And he would stay with us until he figured out where he would live. It's probably a good idea, but seriously, I can't remember more boring things than Vic. He was some kind of philologist, went into sales, so to say, from boredom to deadly boredom. Why the hell should we welcome him? Especially since I'm not a baby anymore. I'm 17. Give me a credit card and I'll be fine for at least a year without any Vic. Did you have to defend your independence in front of your parents? I didn't want to argue. Why spoil people's vacation? I'll bear it. In any case, neither my nor my parents' expectations were met. When Vic arrived, we were like, kid, and where is Vic? It's just that Vic was all covered in tattoos. Well, okay, not all of him, but like the neck, arms, back, legs, except the face was open. And he still was such a nice guy in glasses and a shirt. It was crazy. Of course, my parents weren't sure if I should be left alone with Vic. But when he started talking about irregular verbs, Ma and Pa were relieved and went away. I thought it wouldn't be so bad at first. Yeah. It was even worse. Vic wasn't just a college
ever wondered how to get a grade 9 in maths GCSE? It turns out you don't need to be naturally good at maths.
Here, you'd better sit down. About 1 year ago now, a truck crashed into your...
Details are everything, so I need a trimmer that handles every detail like a pro. And no slip-ups. Fading is one of the most crucial parts to perfecting my look. Every edge is a fine line between untidy and sharp. Professional precision and 100% control.
Ever wondered how to get a grade 9 in maths GCSE? It turns out you don't need to be naturally good at maths. Studies are back.
Nobody understood me at home or at school. My parents.
Energy. Okay, go.
Oblast. Were constantly busy with work and only paid attention to me when I was sick, while all the other little girls were sharing secrets with their moms and basking in their father's care. I only ever heard, "Jane, we're busy right now," and that actually really hurt me. And
the end, I just gave up on trying to get closer to my parents. It wasn't any better at school, though. Due to my lack of parental warmth, I grew up a prickly little teenager, and I